Welcome to Victory Fellowship Church. Stand with me as we get ready to start our service. Glory to God. We are the little church with a big heart. We are doing great big things for God. And every time we touch a soul, it's a great big thing for God. Can we just pray a moment? Father, thank you so much, Lord, for being in our service today. Bless what we do, Father. Let your healing balm of Gilead flow through this nation and through this service today, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Give the Lord a clap offering and remain standing as we worship the Lord.
Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. So good to see everyone this morning. Let's be sure to lift up those in prayer that are not able to be with us today. And others of our number that have not been feeling well. Lord Jesus, I just lift up to you right now. Anyone that's in the sound of my voice, any of our church members that are not here, that normally would be here, Lord, I just pray that you touch them in Jesus' name and heal them, Lord, and heal this nation as well in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. He is worthy. Sing it with us today.
Do you know that all the dark won't stop the light?
together. For every people and tribe, every nation and tongue, he is worthy. God bless you. You may be seated. Amen. He has been made worthy. He was God in the flesh to start with. To get untangled here. He was God in the flesh to start with, but boy, he suffered and died for us and completed our salvation. And then man, praise God. Glory to God. So God has offered himself as a sacrifice for all, for every people and tribe, every nation and tongue. His love goes out to every person in the whole world. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. I want to preach this morning about, is there a healing balm in Gilead? And that healing balm was made by Manasseh, one of the 12 tribes of Israel, and it was used to put on cuts and scrapes and bruises, and it would bring healing. And the type of healing that I'm talking about today is what we need in our nation, a healing balm in our nation, a healing not only between blacks and whites, but a healing between husband and wife, a healing between sons and daughters and their parents, a healing between all peoples. We need God's healing balm. But God is passionate. We are made in his image, saints, but God is passionately against evil, and he's passionately for good. Amen. And passionately means you have enthusiasm toward a particular thing. And you can tell if a person is enthusiastic by what they pour their life into. You could tell that Jesus was enthusiastic about you because he poured his life into you. Glory to God. He was enthusiastic about each one of you. And he poured out himself on the cross of Calvary as the healing balm of Gilead. And it went forth to the whole world, to every nation and tribe, every people and tongue. He was and is and will continue to be passionate for people. He loves each of you today with the same love and passion that he had when he died for you on the cross, and it will never end. And for you, those of you that know Jesus, he's forever trying to bless you more. He's forever trying to draw you into his presence more. He's forever trying to work good things in your life. And saints, if we're a willing participant in that, God will pour out good things in our life. He's passionate about blessing his people. Hebrews 12, verse 2 says this, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross. The joy that was set before him was seeing you and I come to salvation. It was seeing you and I make heaven. It was seeing you and I have a relationship with him that was vibrant and full. Jesus said, I have come that thou may have life and have it more abundantly. Know this, that it's God's desire to bless every person on planet Earth. Can you say amen? God is passionate about what is right and pure and holy. He is passionate about healing. He's passionate about helping people. He's passionate about justice and what is fair to all people. God is the champion of social justice, and he's passionately against all social injustice. He is equally passionate for the good in the lives of all people, no matter what nationality, no matter what race. Look at this glimpse of heaven. And my daughter
Brittany didn't know what I was going to be talking about today, and she picked a song that talked about every nation and tribe, every people and tongue. She had no idea what I was going to include in my sermon today. But take a look at Revelation chapter 7, verse 9. You don't have to turn there this morning. I've got it right here. But just listen a minute. Revelation chapter 7, verse 9 says, "After this I beheld, and lo, a great multitude which no man could number, of all nations, all kindreds, and all people and tongues. They stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes." Hallelujah. When we get to heaven, saints, there's going to be black and white people. There's going to be Chinese. There's going to be Oriental. There's going to be Spanish. There's going to be every type. And I don't believe at all there's going to be the black section segregated off and the white section here. I believe it's going to be a beautiful thing of black and white and white and black and Spanish and every kind all mixed in, because there's not going to be segregation in heaven. There's going to be brothers and sisters worshiping God and praising God with all their heart, and there will no be no barriers or any prejudice in heaven. Can you say amen? Glory to God. Acts 10:34 says this, "God is no respecter of persons." That's in the King James Version. If you'd like it in the NIV, I can give it to you this morning. It says, "God does not show favoritism." If you'd like it in the English Standard Version, I can give that to you. "God shows no partiality. He is just as passionate to see good things happen in the life of a black person as he is in the life of a white person, and just as much vice versa." If each of us could only get a little glimpse about how passionately God wants to love us and bless us, it would turn our life upside down. Because God is so immense in what he does. His love for us is beyond what we could possibly imagine. There's a scripture that says he's able to do exceedingly abundantly above more than we could ask or think. But his love for us goes beyond what we could possibly imagine. But if you think for a minute about what he went through on the cross of Calvary, the nails that he took in his hands, first of all, how he was God in the flesh and made himself a human being, he gave his all for you. The way you can tell a person is passionate about something is, do they give all of what they have to that particular thing? People that are training for the Olympics, they give all that they have for that gold medal. People that love their profession, they give all that they have and pour themselves into that profession. Jesus gave all that he had for you. Hallelujah, hallelujah. And we have the perspective of God the Father, who gave all that he had for you. He gave his most precious thing, his only begotten Son. He gave what was most valuable to him to you, so that you would have salvation. Of course, Jesus, the second person of the Trinity, was God in the flesh, and Jesus held nothing back for you and I. Glory to God. We serve a passionate God, a passionate God. And he's passionate against Satan and against evil. Aren't you glad? He's passionately against sin, which includes the mistreatment of any person. We don't think of God as hating anything. We don't associate God hating anything. But you know, in Revelation chapter 2, when Jesus is speaking to the church of Ephesus, this is what he says. He says to the church of Ephesus, "You hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate." God said, "I also hate." So he loves the sinner. He loves people. But he absolutely despises sin. And he despises injustice. And he despises evil. And he hates the devil. Glory to God. God's passionately for good and passionately against evil. Amen. Glory to God. Jesus, to give an example of how he doesn't like people mistreated, I'm going to read from Matthew 21 this morning. Again, you don't have to turn there. I've got it right here. "And Jesus went into the temple of God, and he cast all of them that sold and bought in the temple. And he overthrew the tables of the money changers and the seats of them that sold doves. And he said to them, 'It is written, my house shall be called the house of prayer, but you have made it a den of thieves.'" He was angry at the people because the people were robbing other people. People were coming there to buy the doves to sacrifice for their sins as part of their worship, but those that were selling the doves were selling them for an exorbitant, very large price. And knowing that the people, if they wanted to worship God, had no choice but to buy it. God is very upset when we rob other people, when we hurt people. And he was so upset, he took the money changer tables and he flipped them over. And those that sat in the seats, he flipped those over. In another version, another one of the Gospels, it says that he actually made a whip and he drove them out with the whip. Whether he actually hit anybody, I don't know. I wasn't there. But it was certainly enough to put the fear of God in him. Can you say amen? My point is, he was passionately against people being mistreated. He was angry. God does not take lightly when people are mistreated. And Jesus spoke out about racism. You know, the whole, if you look at it, it doesn't say it's a parable, so we have to believe it really did happen. Jesus talked about the Good Samaritan. Do y'all remember the story of the Good Samaritan? How there was a man that came down from Jerusalem going to Jericho, presumably a Jew, and he was robbed and beaten and left half dead alongside the road. And then two religious people that were Jews came and they saw the man that was half dead beside the road, but they walked by on the other side. They didn't have compassion on him. They just walked right on by. And being those were religious Jews, they didn't even help their fellow Jew that was alongside the road. And along came a Samaritan. And a Samaritan at that time was considered a half-breed. The Syrians had invaded Israel, and some of the Israelites intermingled with the Syrians. And the Jews hated the Samaritans. And that Samaritan that came by that day, he knew that he was a part of a tribe of people that the Jews hated. Yet this good Samaritan reached out and helped the Jew. Say amen. Hallelujah. The love has to go between. That Samaritan didn't care about what the other Samaritans thought about what he was doing. That Samaritan didn't care about what the Jews thought of him. That Samaritan only cared about one thing, and that's loving that other person and doing the will of God and letting the love of God flow through him. Hallelujah. So Jesus stands against racism. God is passionately for people and passionately against sin. Now, saints, listen. The Bible says that we are all made in the image of God. We are all made, even before we get saved, we're made with a knowledge of good and evil. We're created with a conscience. And we are, because we're made in His image, we have the potential to be very passionate against evil and very passionate for good. Because we're made in His image, we have intelligence. God does too. Of course, He has a lot more intelligence. Can you say amen? God has emotions. We do too. God knows right from wrong. Say it with me. We do too. God hates seeing people mistreated or killed. We do too. I want you to know something. It's okay to be angry at injustice because God got angry when He overturned the money changers' tables. He gets angry at misjustice. It's okay for us to get angry at misjustice, injustice. There's several types of injustice. One is the unborn children. There's still unborn babies killed 3,000 a day. 3,000 per day, every day, on the average, of unborn children killed. And I'm glad for those that protest outside the abortion clinics. I'm glad for that. I'm not for bombing the clinics, right? But I'm glad that we have the right to protest against that. Aren't you, saints? We should never forget the injustice of 3,000 babies per day being killed in this nation. And thank God for the activists that are moving and helping that, hopefully the laws to be reversed in that area. How about the abuse of children? Thank God for those that are working in the area of sex trafficking. So many children, there's people, I heard a report, I think it was 20 last month in our nation, of children that were cared for by either their parents or care workers were killed at the hands of those that cared for them. That's injustice, saints, that we should be angry about. There's spousal abuse. There's minority discrimination. I mean, there's people that are overweight are discriminated against. People that are handicapped are made fun of. Women, you know, you realize it was just in 1920 that women had the right to vote. They were considered property up until that point in time. Thank God that through the prayers of godly people, women have come up in the world. Amen? Glory to God. And I mentioned last week, blacks didn't get the right to vote till in the 60s, the 1960s. But there, every person God's created is of equal value in His sight. The poor are discriminated against. People that are just plain different than you or different than us, if we're not careful, we can think less of them. Believe me, God doesn't think less of them. He does not think less. He puts everyone. He died just as much for them as you. So all these things, all these injustices should make us angry. But that anger should motivate us to action, okay? That anger should motivate us to action, like it did with Jesus and the money changers. And it's okay to take action, but that action must be godly and appropriate. Ephesians 4:26 says this, "Be ye angry and sin not. Let not the sun go down upon your wrath. But see, if you dwell on it," that means don't go to bed, don't hold on to it all day long. The longer you hold on to anger, it so easily can become bitterness and vengeance and hate. So it's good to be angry and let it motivate you to action, but not sinful action. Amen? Let your anger motivate you to action, but not sinful action. Those that protest, those that have the signs out in front of the abortion clinics, they're doing that because they hate sin and they hate abortion and they feel passionately about it. And if they're called to do that, that's what they should do. So what is appropriate action to take when you're angry about injustice? Well, for one thing, in Romans chapter 13 in the NIV, this is the way it reads. Everyone must submit himself to the governing authorities, for there's no authority except that which God has established. I'm going to read this again. Focus. Everyone must submit himself to the governing authorities, for there's no authority except that which God has established. Consequently, he who rebels against the authority is rebelling against what God has instituted, and those that do so will bring judgment on themselves. Amen? So it's okay to do the things to protest and to show your anger against injustice as long as you do it within the law. Otherwise, you're disobeying God. So peaceful protesters are within their legal rights to protest, and if they feel led to do so, they do a good thing because they stand up against what's wrong. Very clearly, what happened to George, my brain's drunk, George Floyd. What happened to George Floyd was an injustice. And it's good to see people passionately against evil, but they need to express it in ways that are legal. And thank God this country gives us the right to protest. This country has freedom of speech, the right to protest against evil in the nation, as long as we do it peacefully and within the law. The United States gives us the right to freely say what we're against and to stand together against that thing. Aren't you glad America allows that? Can you give the Lord a clap offering? America allows that. Try doing that in China. You say anything that disagrees with the government, you're going to be imprisoned or beheaded. Try doing that in North Korea. That's not going to go over well for you. But here in the United States, we have freedom of speech. We can protest peacefully. I'm for people that protest against injustice. And if God leads you as a white person to join our black brothers and sisters and protest peacefully, then you should do it if God leads you to do it, to show solidarity. As long as you be aware that there's a small percentage of people that might be a part of that group that have evil on their mind. So you want to be prayed up and have the blood of Jesus covering you when you go into those situations. Can you say amen? We Christians, black and white, all races, must be sure that we're part of the solution, not part of the problem. I saw a video last night, and it was about a young teen, a young black man in one of the cities in New York. And there had been some protests near where he lived. And he was about 18 years old. And in the protests, the people that did the protest broke windows, did violence, did looting. And this young teenage black man, he knew that the next day people of all colors would have to be using that street. So at 2 a.m., he began cleaning up that street. And he worked for 10 straight hours from 2 a.m., when most people would want to be sleeping, and I'm sure he wanted to be sleeping, but he felt like he needed to do his part and clean up the mess. And from 2 a.m. to 12 noon the next day, he worked cleaning up the glass, getting it out of the street for those that would need to use it the next day. The group came in the next day to clean the streets from the city, and most of the job had been done. Here's a man that he didn't cause the mess. He's not the one that broke the glass, but he made an effort to be part of the solution and clean up the problem. Amen. See, the Good Samaritan that came by, he didn't cause the mess. He didn't cause that man to be off on the side of the road half dead, but he was going to do his part to help clean up the mess. Interesting thing, this black teen, another white man, probably in his 20s, saw what the black teen had done, and the white man had a car that he was trying to sell, a 2004 Red Mustang. We're partial to Red Mustangs. Amen. And he didn't know what to do with the car. He hadn't been able to sell it yet, and he really felt like he wanted to give this car to the black teen. And that's what he did. He gave the card to the black teen. Amen? And one thing the white man didn't know was that the black teen had lost his mom about a year earlier, and the kind of car she drove, guess what, was a red Mustang. My point is, if there's going to be a healing balm in Gilead, we've got to do our part in cleaning up messes. You see, the priest and the Levite that came by, they had the attitude, that's not my problem. I didn't cause it. I'm not going to do anything about it. I've got my responsibilities for the day. I'm sorry it happened, but it is what it is. And as long as we, people of both sides of the race issue, as long as we consider it not our problem because we didn't do it, then we're not going to have a heart of compassion. We need to have a heart of compassion and do what we can to bring a healing balm in Gilead. Can you say amen? So God said in Jeremiah chapter 8, verse 22, he says, is there a healing balm in Gilead? It was a time where he was bringing judgment on Israel for their sin, but he was crying out from the depth of his heart, and he was saying, is there any healing that can be done? Is there anything that can be done to heal the divide? And of course, there is. Amen. It's called love, and you love people of all color in all races. Nehemiah, do you remember Nehemiah, what he did when he found out that the wall of Jerusalem had been broken down? When he got the news and the wall of Jerusalem had been broken and it was on fire, it came to pass when Nehemiah heard these words that he sat down and wept and he mourned certain days and he fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. The first thing we got to do is care about what's going on in our nation. It's not just George Floyd. It's stuff that's gone on for years and years and years. But my point is, are you going to be part of the problem or part of the solution? Are you going to love all people no matter what? Well, you may say, well, Pastor Greg, what's my part? Number one, pray. You pray for our nation. Say it with me. If my people, which are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and forgive their sin and heal their land. And that healing balm is a spiritual healing that needs to happen in our nation. You see, God can use the George Floyd situation to bring healing, to actually bring a revival, to actually unite the blacks and whites. If Christian blacks and Christian whites will allow that to happen, God could use it to bring a revival and unite our nation like never before. Amen? Let's be part of the solution. Take action. You know, it's little things like Matthew and I were eating in a restaurant the other day, and there was a black couple there, and I wanted to be sure to look them in the eye and greet them as they left the restaurant. Why? Because whatever little part I can do, I want to let them know that I respect them. Just that I don't see color. I'm colorblind. Amen? We ought to be colorblind. Love people. Take advantage of where you are to do what you can in the name of Jesus. Pray and then do whatever God asks you to do. Stand up. Be passionate against evil. Be passionate for good. It's good to see people standing up against evil. Amen? It's good to see that. But we need to do it in the right way, saints, through love and prayer and in abidance with the law. Amen? I'd like us to bow our heads and pray today. I want to pray for our nation. I want to pray for that healing balm to flow like a river. Father, you know what's going on in our nation. You know that the racial divide was there way before George Floyd. And Father, I'm praying in the name of Jesus that you would rise up Christians, black Christians and white Christians and every other color Christians, that they would stand strong against evil no matter what, that they would stand strong for good no matter what, and that they would reach out and be part of the solution, be part of the cleanup process, if you will, no matter what. And God, we need your help every step of the way. Lord, have mercy on our nation. We're your people, and as we pray, Lord, bring healing to this nation. Lord, use what's been going on this last week or two, Lord. Use it to bring revival to the nation. Use it to bring healing between races. Hallelujah. Father, we give you thanks and we give you praise, Lord, for doing the work, Lord, for doing the work in our hearts, for bringing healing, Lord, to this nation and even to the world. In Jesus' holy name, amen and amen. All right, stand with me as we sing our last song this morning. Yes, amen. God's good. God is so good to us. Praise the Lord. We need to go deeper with God, saints. We need to draw upon his power, his mercy, his grace to reach out to all peoples. So that's what God did. That's what he does. Amen.
Thank you. are mine. God. Amen. 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 Glory to God. Glory to God. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you for being with us, Lord. Call us out deeper in you, Lord. Call us out. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. Amen. Well, thank you for joining us today online. If you would like to support this ministry, send your monies to P.O. Box 134 in Bartow, Florida, 33830. And please join us every week at 10:30. Glory to God, online on Facebook. We love you. God loves you. And keep looking up. Amen.